सो पिचेस एंड अजम्पशंस राइट, एंड द कहानी विथ पिचेस एंड अजम्पशंस इज विच अजम्पशंस, हम किन अजम्पशंस की बात करें. फिर रिमेंबर हमने जब शुरू में बात की थी, व्हेन वी स्टार्टेड इन द बिगिनिंग वी सेड दैट यू आर ट्राइंग टू सॉल्व अ पजल राइट, यू आर ट्राइंग टू फाइंड अ सोल्यूशन फॉर अ प्रॉब्लम एंड दिस इज अ रेपिटेटिव इटरेटिव एक्सरसाइज. सो द थ्री प्राइमरी सेट्स ऑफ अजम्पशंस दैट वी लुकिंग एट दैट यू नीड टू वैलिडेट. ओके, द फर्स्ट डील्स विद कस्टमर्स एंड मार्केट्स, द सेकंड डील्स विद प्रोडक्ट्स एंड फीचर्स, एंड द थर्ड डील्स विद प्राइस राइट. एंड द वे टू लुक एट दिस इज आई लुक एट दिस एज think of it as a cube, right? It's a three-dimensional puzzle. And one of your dimensions is markets and customers. One is products and features. Let's draw this line, right? And one is price. So ye teen aapke paas dimensions, aur aap in teen dimensions mein एक ऐसा पॉइंट ढूंढ रहे हैं, यू ट्राइंग टू लुक फॉर अ सोल्यूशन दैट ऑप्टिमाइजेस दैट सॉल्व्स फॉर समथिंग विच इज वायबल राइट, एंड दैट समथिंग इज जस्ट एसेंशियली द स्पेस इनसाइड दिस इंटायर क्यूब. सो मार्केट्स एंड कस्टमर्स, प्रोडक्ट्स एंड फीचर्स एंड प्राइसेस, दीज आर थ्री प्राइमरी सेट्स ऑफ अजम्पशंस दैट यू वांट टू वैलिडेट, एंड यू वांट टू वैलिडेट द वेरी वेरी क्विकली राइट, यू हैव अ लॉट ऑफ टाइम. Because generally, you know, you have about 2.5 to 3 months of runway before you need to make a call on whether the idea that you're working on is going forward, is moving forward, or does it need to be culled and put down. Now, when you talk about the critical assumptions, what assumptions are there, right? So the first is with respect to product market fit. And that is the problem that you're working on, is that a problem that people want to solve and are willing to pay for it? Right, so a lot of you said, I want to write a book. Some of you said, I want to write a book on sci-fi. Some said, I want to write a book on stories. Somebody said, I want to write a book on getting into grad school. Somebody said, I want to write a book on, you know, how to go beyond being an engineer, right? These are all interesting topics, topics that you think are of interest, right? But is this a problem that people are willing to pay for? Is it something that they want solved? Is it so... So right now, if you ask the world, you know, what is the world looking for? What is the biggest space that you think has opened up in the last 4 months that wasn't big enough or that didn't exist 4 months ago? So remote learning existed, but not in this way, right? So, but anything remote, so remote learning, remote working, remote meeting, remote engagement, remote conversations, remote socializing, remote chit chat, right? Remote gossiping, all of this remote stuff was there before. But not in the way it has picked up now. But this is like a first order effect, right? What's the second order effect? You understand the difference between first order effect and second order effect, right? First order effects are direct effects. We can't meet, so we have to do it on Zoom or on Teams or on phone or on WhatsApp, right? That's the first order. What's the second order effect? So, for example, the first order effect is because everyone's gone remote and we need to do stuff remotely, there is a need for remote learning, remote meeting, remote conferencing, right? But a second order effect is that beyond the remote learning piece, you need two things. You need good, solid bandwidth, reliable bandwidth, not bandwidth that goes under, and you need good, solid, reliable power. So that's gone up. That's the second order effect. And then people need spaces to sit and work and talk and converse and engage. So remote, so essentially furniture for home offices, you know, comfortable desks, comfortable chairs. You can't have a board meeting on your lunch table, right? And again, you can't have a board meeting in your lounge when you have people walking all across, right? So you need a quiet, comfortable, you can't teach a class in an open room setting. So these are second order effects. Does that make sense? So health hygiene measures, absolutely, health hygiene is a big second order effect because you're no longer active, because you're stuck at home. And it's not just health hygiene in terms of physical health and hygiene, there's a big issue with mental health. We're social animals by definition, so if you're just locked up, cooped up inside the house without any consistent social contact, you know, you're going to drive yourself mad, right? So that's the product, that's one part, right? The second part of this is, are there enough people who will pay to make this work for you? So, you know, you want to write a book and you want to put it together and you want to sell it and you speak to five people and they all say, yes, I'll buy it, right? But those five may be your friends, cousins, family members, relatives. But is there a bigger enough market outside of that? And then how many copies do you need to sell to break even? So for example, if you say that I need to earn, let's say, about $12,000 a year to cover all my costs, that's about $1,000 a month. And how many copies of the book do I need to sell to make my ends meet? And let's say on every copy of a book that I sell, I make $10. So I need to make about, say, I need to sell about, say, 1,200 copies. I need to sell about 100 copies a month. So are there enough people who'll buy, copies of my book so that I get 100 copies a month and I get 1,200 copies a year and I make about $12,000 a year to cover my living expenses? And then the third question is, can you make it, build it, source it cheaper than people are willing to pay for it? Right? These are assumptions, right? We assume that this is possible, but how do you validate them? You have to go out in the real world and ask people. And there are multiple ways of validating them. We'll talk about them later, but let's just talk about what other assumptions are there. So this is one, right? The second is with respect to features. So the product side, right? Which features do customers want? Which features they don't care about? Which features customers are willing to pay extra for? Which of these features our competition doesn't have? So if you remember, we did this Excel spreadsheet long time back that you also submitted, the product feature matrix. Yeah. So that's your sheet, right? So that's the sheet that basically you use to answer these questions. And then the third part is price. What is the value we're delivering? How much can we charge for it? How much does the competition charge? How much money are we leaving on the table? So three, and there are more, right? So within these, you know, I've said, if I go back, I've said that there are three dimensions. There is market and customers, there is products and features, and there's price. But market and customers by themselves is also three-dimensional. Product features, also three-dimensional. Price, also three-dimensional. So you're not looking at a three-dimensional grid. You're actually saying, I'm going to solve a problem with nine dimensions. With one sub-dimension at a time. So I'm going to start with price, which is three dimensions. I'm going to do product features, which is three dimensions. I'm going to market customers, which is three dimensions. And then we'll take all of them together, which is another three dimensions. So that's about nine dimensions in all, which is the biggest reasons why making a startup work, making a new idea work, making a business get to a point where it's viable and sustainable is such a hard task, because it's not a problem set we are thought to solve or even frame or express in our normal life. Like, when was the last time you went home and said, you know, Ma, I had such a great day today. We solved a nine-dimensional integral today in class. And I loved it. So it's not a simple problem. It's a complex problem. And that's the reason why we need to give it the attention it deserves, right? So how do you reduce complexity? You reduce complexity by validating the nine dimensions for n equals 1, right? When I say n equals 1, what does that mean? That means validate it for one customer. Find one customer, just one customer. You want to find hundreds of, just find one customer who's willing to pay for it, right? And then with that one customer, have a one-on-one. And this customer interview that you're having is very simple. It says, I'm trying to do this. Is this a problem? So I want to write a book on getting into grad school. Is this a problem you want solved? Will you pay for it? I am going to write a book on a collection of short sci-fi stories. Will you pay for it? As in, will you buy the book from me and read it? So that's one, right? So is this a problem? Will you have it? Will you pay to have it solved? How do you use it? So when do you read the sci-fi book? What kind of sci-fi books do you want to read? You know, what kind of sci-fi books do you like? What kind of sci-fi books do you really, really appreciate? Do you like hard science or do you like soft science? You know, what's the difference? What do you do right now? What do you use right now to solve this problem? What do you like about what you have right now? What do you hate about it? What in the current solution is broken? How would you go about fixing it? What makes you angry when you use this product or the current product, right? What makes you happy? How does this help you get you where you want to be, right? So if I play Call of Duty, right? If I play Civilization or if I watch sci-fi movies, right? How does this help me get where I want to be or who I want to be? These are all questions. So what you want to do is you want to ask these questions. First, find one customer and then ask that one customer questions that you want answered and then validate it for n equals to 1. So one of the biggest mistakes I've seen you make, and not just you, you know, everybody makes this mistake. I've made the same mistake myself. One of the biggest mistakes we make is we say, okay, there is a market. The market exists. I'm assuming there will be at least 100 people who will buy my book. Are you sure? I'm sure 100 people will at least download my app. Okay, they'll download the app, but is that the desired behavior? Downloading the app is not desired behavior, right? Working, engaging, using the app is desired behavior. So not 100 people will download the app. Will 100 people use the app? Not 100 people will download the game. Will 100 people play the game? But you don't get to 100. You know, you start with one. You say, I'm going to find one customer, one real, actual, sincere customer who says this is a problem and I'm willing to pay for it. And then, you know, sort of you then extend the question, right? Okay, how much are you willing to pay for it? You know, how frequently are you going to use it? You know, how important is this to your continued mental health and well-being for you to have this product, and so on and so forth. So ask those questions. So another thing that you have to do, and this is an assignment, and it's a really important assignment, and I'll talk about this a little later, is for the idea that you're working on, the one that you're pitching and presenting, I need you to go out and find one real customer. I want you to engage with that one real customer, and I want you to record that interview, and I want you to share that interview with me. So you spend a lot of time on figuring out what the pitch is, you figure out what the market size is, you have a sense of what the features are, you have a sense of how the product is working out. And even for those of you who are working on papers explaining and talking about the impact and what things, you know, identify one person who fits the persona you've identified, right? Go out to that one person and record. Ask them the questions and record. You know, have a Zoom call, have a Teams call, have whatever call that works. So you record that call and then share that call with me. So now let's talk about pitches and assumptions, right? So in this specific case, if you remember the Plainspeak pitch, shared the Plainspeak pitch, intelligent financial conversations on Pakistan. Yeah, right. So this was a Plainspeak pitch, right? Plainspeak pitch was 2008, 2013, 2018, 3 years, three elections, three exchange rate adjustments, trend, conspiracy, coincidence. The USD PKR rate fell from 60 to 140 in 11 years. What drove that shift? Wouldn't you like to know, right? No hidden agendas, trading positions, bias of baggage, data-driven commentary, analysis, insights on the Pakistan. This is your pitch, right? Now, with this pitch, the big question is, who's the customer? One high-level information is what most of us do. Say, okay, I'm going to go to Alexa. I'm going to look at the Alexa ranking for Dawn, for News, for Tribune, right? And get a sense of where do customers come from. So if I look at Dawn, Dawn tells me that bulk of my customers come from, so 47% come from Pakistan, but 53% come from outside Pakistan. News tells me 55% come from Pakistan and 45% come from outside Pakistan. Tribune tells me 64% come from Pakistan and the remaining 36% come from outside Pakistan. But one of the assumptions I made is I said these guys, the Pakistani guys, the Pakistani customers, are not going to pay for this service. So I'm happy to have their traffic. I'm happy to sort of give them freebies and premiums, but these are not people who are going to pay for reading news online. And if they're not going to pay for reading news online, then that's not the target customer I want to focus on. I want to focus on Pakistanis outside Pakistan. Do you understand what I'm saying? So a lot of you said, you know, women in Pakistan represent 50% of the population, X percent, 30%, you know, live in urban areas, Y percent are educated, they're all my customers. No, they're not all your customers. Just because they are literate, just because they're educated, just because they live in urban centers, just because they read a newspaper does not mean that they're going to read your book. You have to dig deeper than that. So in this specific case, our dig was, we said the Pakistanis, the Desi Pakistani crowd is not going to pay for news. So we have to go outside Pakistan. So we have to look at all these guys who are outside Pakistan, right? All of these guys, all of this market outside Pakistan, the circles, right? And I have to ask them, guys, do you pay for news in any shape and form? So what do? I found Riz. So this is not a fake profile. This is an actual person. And this is based on an actual conversation. I asked him, kya karte ho? What do you do? How do you read? How do you catch up? What are the issues? So I had this persona. I used him to validate that persona. That's what you have to do. And that's what you have to do here. In the sense, when I say, okay, find a real customer, have a conversation with him, engage him, ask him questions, talk to him about it, get a sense of what he or she wants, record it, and then send it to me. Okay, so this is an assignment. And the reason why this is important is because you have a sense of your pitch, right? But you haven't validated it. So if you can't even find a single customer, and I understand, you know, times of COVID, times of Corona, but within your extended network, if you can't find even a single use case of one single person using a product and paying, and he or she cannot be immediate family or sibling or relatives. So you can't go to your father and say, okay, Abba, are you going to pay for this? Because, you know, I need to get this assignment done and I will fail this course if I don't get this done. So can you please say yes? And Abba will say yes. And then he says, okay, so please answer these questions. No, that doesn't work. So find somebody who's not immediate family member, not somebody you live in the same house with, not somebody who's a relative, and then ask him about your product thesis and validate it. And if you can't find one customer, then I'm sorry, you don't have a market. So now when you go back to n is equal to 1, one of the big steps that comes, it's not just a question of n equals to 1, just validate it. Then you also want to do maybe one transaction with that one customer. Okay, so you know, Jalal asked me that I want to do fundraising for students who need funding for going outside Pakistan. I said, right. I said, find one customer who needs to raise funding and raise funding for him. You're at Habib University, right? There are 900 students at Habib University. Somebody must be going outside to study. So whoever is going outside to study, find funding for them. And if you can't find funding for one person, if you can't find that one person, and you can't find funding for that one person, then it's not going to fly. Then I'm sorry, the idea has no... The way that... Maybe the idea has legs and merits, but the way that you looked at it doesn't have legs or merits, because you don't... You don't understand it well enough to find a customer that works. Same thing with Chinese, right? You want to teach Chinese, Sarah, right? You want to teach Chinese and teach Chinese to find one person who's willing to pay to learn Chinese. And then speak to him and ask him, why do you want to learn Chinese? Why do you want to ask? Okay. So in the case of Plainspeak, the structure was very simple. The customer was outside Pakistan, and the reason why the customer was outside Pakistan because we thought, the assumption that we made, that customers outside Pakistan may be willing to pay for it. But are there enough such customers? That's the big question, right? Can we find enough such customers? And then more importantly, can we actually produce news at a cost where these enough such customers can pay for that cost to be covered? And again, you know, the focus is, you again made assumptions about validating the customer's pain points. So what are those pain points? What do they look like? And do they tie in and align with your cases, right? So now what you're going to do, you do some very quick, very rough, very short practice cases. I'm going to show you a pitch or a theme or an image or a banner or a poster, and then you have to tell me what the underlying assumptions are. Okay, and this is again a graded exercise, which basically means everybody has to participate. Your chat script is basically what I use for grading purposes. Your responses and quality of responses. So I don't want, you can't, if something's said or identified or highlighted, you can't use it. You have to come up with new responses and new ideas. So only original ideas get credit for grading purposes, right? And there are like 4 or 5 cases, so you have enough time, you'll have enough shots, right? So case number one, you've seen this before also, is Runners United Half Marathon. What is the assumption? Tell me. What are the assumptions? Go. On your mark, get set, go. So in this specific instance, the assumptions are, can we get 50 runners willing to run a half marathon with us in Karachi on 23rd March 2000? Sorry, this was the year before. This is 2018. Yep. Are they willing to pay some money to run? So do they want to run for free, or will they willing? Because, you know, there's some cost attached, right? Third is, can we find a sponsor to pay for all these expenses? Fifth is, can we execute in 20 days? Sixth is, can we find volunteers to manage the process of registration and organization? And can you find organizers to manage the event on the event day, right? And what time does the event start? The event starts at, registration starts at 5:30 a.m. The first race starts at 6 a.m. sharp. So can you get 50 people? Can you get 50 people to run a half marathon? Pay money to run that marathon? Can we find sponsor to pay for expenses? Can we get this up and running? Yes, Anara, go ahead. Ask. So there are bibs. There are registration bibs, which basically means that you're actually wearing a identifier that has your race number on it. So we know who has paid for it and who hasn't paid for it. But we don't have a problem. If you sort of join us mid-race and just want to run with us for a while, that's also fine. All right? Okay, so next. So how do you test these assumptions? How do you know whether you'll get 50 runners or not? Can you get 50 runners or not, right? So how do we know this? We know this because Speedstar, Sports Movement, Magnus, Karachi Striders, TCW, Revolution, these. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are running clubs. And our first question was, you know, between these running clubs, can you get 50 people? And we said, yes, we can. Okay. Second, you know, there is the SOP half marathon. And the SOP half marathon is, I think, about 18 to 23 kilometers, depending on which year you run it. And we have a sense of how many people come to the SOP marathon. So we have a sense of the starting lineup on the SOP marathon, right? So we have that as a benchmark. So we know for a fact that we should be able to get 50 people, right? Will they pay money to run it? So we don't want to charge a lot. We just want to buy 500 rupees or 1,000 rupees for registration, right? Just to cover basic expenses. So we got that. Can we find a sponsor to pay for all the expenses? We can try. So make like, in all of these instances, these are questions that have to be asked to people who can answer. So I spoke to 4 sponsors. One of them said yes. We spoke to most of the runners. We got a sense of how many we will pay. We just did a quick WhatsApp poll on the main primary runners group. Guys, you're doing this. How much money are you willing to pay? Are you willing to pay 500? They said yes. Can we do and execute in 20 days? Maybe. Not sure, but maybe. Why maybe? Because we've done many events like this in the past where we set up and got started, right? Can we find volunteers? Yes. Can we find organizers? Yes. Why? Because we've done this multiple times. So testing is the key part. Testing requires you to pick up the phone and talk or go out in the market and ask. Engage. You cannot do testing sitting on your laptop doing research on the internet. I want to be very, very clear about this, right? You understood how to do market sizing, but a lot of that sizing is based on assumptions. So sizing may make sense mathematically, numerically, right? But from a actual, practical, realistic point of view, it doesn't. You have to go out and ask. All right, here's the next one. Pain is temporary, pride lasts forever. This is the Karachi Cross Country Championship. Okay, what's the assumption here? Okay, so the assumptions are, will normal runners be interested in running a cross-country event in Karachi? So that's the sponsor, right? Will you get a sponsor? It's the same set of questions again. You know, will they be willing to pay money to run? Will you find a sponsor? Will you execute 20 days? Will you find organizers? Will you find volunteers? Next one. Portfolio optimization model in Excel. Third edition, Jawad Ahmed Farid. What's the assumption? You all did the how to sell a million copies of a book exercise, right? So what's so hard about this one? There are people who want to learn about this. Very good, Anisa. That's great. So that's a question. That's not an assumption, right? What are you providing? So the assumption is that you're providing something that people can't learn from YouTube tutorials, right? That you actually have the credibility and the background and the credentials to teach this. Anyone else? No? Okay. So now, how do you test it? You test it, if you notice, this is the third edition. This is the first edition. Why would somebody do a third edition if the first edition was a failure? No, why would people buy a book is the question. What's the assumption? And then how do you test it? So if you want to test the price, you want to find out how much people are going to buy it for, how do you go about it? If you have places where you can generate traffic, what do? You can simply put up a banner ad or a sales ad or a sales block and see, you know, how many people convert and how to be. So if you push traffic, if you get traffic to land on a specific landing page for the book, right, you can put up a buy now button this framework. Your assumptions are essentially in the areas of markets and customers, products and features, and pricing. You should be able to list down at least 10 assumptions each for each of the dimensions, which basically means there are at least 30 experiments you need to conduct, 30 experiments that you need to execute in order for you to validate your underlying assumptions. Just like I said, you know, if you can't find a single customer, you don't have a product or a market, or you're not meant to do this. Similarly, if you can't identify 30 assumptions, you're not in good shape. You haven't sort of done a good enough job thinking about this. All right, Greece is the word. What's the assumption? This is the banner for a play. What's the assumption? What I want you to do, your next assignment is I want you to find a real customer, interview him or her, record the interview, load the interview on YouTube as an unlisted interview, and then share the link with me, right? And this needs to be done at a group level. So each team, each project idea that's working on this needs to go out and get this done. This is a lot. Think of this as your final test, right? You've gotten the pitches done. You've gotten a sense of how to go about estimating market sizes. You have a sense of the idea you're working on. Find me a real customer. And a real customer, obviously, you know, you speak to them and say, I want to do this. And they say, okay, yeah, I'm interested. And say, okay, can I have 10 minutes of your time? If they can't give you 10 minutes of their time for you to record the interview, then they're not a real customer. Because they can't give you 10 minutes now, you really think they're going to take money out of the wallet and give you money for buying your product? This is one. And then the second related part of this is, you know, the three dimensions we identified: markets, products, and price. So product, features, and price, right? For these three dimensions, identify at least 10 assumptions each that need to be validated. So call them and talk to them on the phone. You've been having Zoom calls, pick up the phone, call people. I'm doing this, will you be interested in buying it? WhatsApp them, ask them questions on WhatsApp. So you have to basically, my basic assumption is, if you've now understood the problem well enough and you understand how to sell it and promote it, you should be able to find a customer. And we're not saying go out and get that customer to sign you a check for a product that doesn't exist. We're saying people who are interested enough in this product and idea, you must be able to have at least one person. We're not talking about hundreds of people. Just get me one person. That's your final validation. If you can't get that one person, then the idea has no legs. If you can get that one person, then the idea has legs.